Several of you may be wanting to do more, so this can be just a small introduction today here. But if you wanted to do get more help from within our studio, there are two more places. One is here on the R Markdown cheat sheet and under cheat sheets and under the R Markdown reference guide. So this is also where you find can find out more about. More options on the header section or the metadata section and the possibilities to do more things even within the Markdown. But I think for today it just gives you the idea that you can basically do anything you can do in other text editors, you can also do basically this. Well, let's then open another file. So now we go here. There's one file called reproducible RMD. So now we will go into what I presented in the morning, into this combined document, which allows us to intertwine R code with Markdown code. And they are now aptly named RMD, so R plus MD format. And basically, so everybody has been able to find this. File here is called reproducible RMD. Yeah, so it starts out the basic very same thing, and I've kept the sections here just at the very end, under results, as you mainly probably would do in a paper, and you see there, here we have our section R code implemented in small. Frame here, and you see even within the document you get here a small icon which if we can over with the mouse it says run current chunk, so this is fragment or chunk, and then you get here a table inserted but based on R code. So in this case I've combined here various commands from R into one. The secret here is to make it a combined document is to use a certain convention on inserting an R code fragment as we see here. And you see there's this three upper backslashes and then followed by this parentheses, curved parentheses, followed by R, followed by a space, and then you have here some options to apply for your fragment. And then you close it here again. Well, it sounds like a lot. It is a lot to remember, so you can insert your empty fragment just by going also here on the insert button and just adding R. You can even use other languages within this document. As you see here, you can also use even Bash scripts. So if you're in Linux, you could run Bash from within this document. You could use Python, you could use RCPP, you can use SQL, and some other favorite data science languages like Sten or D3. But for the moment, we just keep to R. So here you get an empty empty fragment here. And there you can just type in R code. Like 2 plus 2 or 5, I make it nice, and then you can save it. And even before you want knit it, you can preview it. Just this chunk, and you see it gives you this output as we expect, 7. And we can see the whole document again by pressing the knit button, and it gives you the whole thing. So we have the same first part, and now we have here. You see the source code basically, and then the result. So that's according to our reproducibility demands. That's actually what we want. Now we have full documentation of the original code that does something, and we get the result back into the document. And we can make tables, as we can see here, and we can insert graphs, and we can do lots of fine tuning on that. So this is just the default options, and an even also very nice thing, as you have seen with the formula, we can also insert R code within a line of a text, within the text fragment. So instead of saying explicitly, okay, this database has 50 records, I can make a variable, putting in there and counting it. And then if I have another document, I just switch a database. So let's go over it, how this works. Okay, so Shift Control 1, you can make the whole screen for the editor here. And so let's go over it one by one. So if in this case here, in the second fragment, one of the differences is here, I put in an option which says echo is false. So if you look again at the HTML document of that and compare with the previous one, so we had here our 2+5 and the result. So this is two fragments, no? Two blocks, the code and the result. And here in the next one, we know it's a table, but we don't see the original code. So in some cases, you don't want to put in some like code that is only laterally important. So for a reader of a paper, it's not too much of interest to see maybe the formatting of the table specifically. So you just can take this out of the text. And that is what this option does. Echo means no false. You won't show this line of command. It only shows the result. And so there are several options which you can use to fine tune this. You can set that by hand. Also, you can here on the mini menu on top of this code block in R, you can give it a name. For example, it's like table one. And you see here, now it inserts this text over here. And then, for example, some of the libraries you use, yeah, they show messages or warnings sometimes that you want to get rid of. And so you can just turn it off or on. You can put in here a custom figure size for if you want to make it a bit smaller or bigger in width, in inches, and so on. So let me just give it it's a good practice to give the chunks an option. Because sometimes, no, more often than not, when you work on a new document, you also commit errors. So you want to know where did you get an error, and in the output on your console, when it compiles, you can see then which code fragment has been difficult to compile. And we just apply it there. Then we see some other options here. This means no run all chunks above. So we do this, no, and it runs the chunks above. So if you want to make sure that your preconditions are met, and then you can also just specifically run the current chunk and inserts you here the result as a table. Yeah, and maybe you don't want it anymore, so you can just hide it for the moment or just take it out again. So we can do now or simply putting in a plot. So we use this dataset cars, which is inbuilt in R, into R, and we can just give one x-axis, a y-axis, and then we do our usual beautifications of the plot. And also again, we just use this here to get a quick feedback on how the plot looks like. Put it until we are satisfied. It just does the R within the document, at a kind of source code level, but combination of the source code and of the text plus the elements of R. So now in the last crucial element here is the insertion of the fragment within a sentence, and we can continue the sentence now. In this case, I need to do the full knit, but just to make the point. So here, you see that this code fragment is just seamlessly integrated into the text. Now this is very powerful if you wanted to, for example, you have on a frequent situation is, now you have a database, field data collected somewhere, and then you do the calculations and you have to report explicitly, I have analyzed so many genotypes and found so many markers. Okay, and then you notice, oh, there were some genotypes mislabeled, so I better take them out. And then you have to go all over the text again and find all the references where you need to make your corrections. And you also need, probably will need to redo your graphs, your tables, because now everything has changed. So lots of work to just go over the text again. So in this case, if you keep everything as a result of an R calculation, you just make sure that you have your basic transformations done within a R fragment as in the beginning, and then you are sure that all the calculations subsequently are okay. What you can also do is to make formatting on this, like maybe you want to do here a bold statement. Just do that again. So now we have a bold 50 number here. So we can combine the formatting of the markdown convention on top of the output of the R code. That's very powerful combination, and that is actually what nowadays also referred to as this reproducible documents, and makes it possible to write really a document that is always synchronized with your database. But you have to keep the discipline to always use R code. But it's also like, as we heard in the beginning, that it's also required, basically don't do any manual changes on your results either. So you will always refer back to the original database and then have just R calculate the results and use markdown to insert back. And this way you're always sure that your numbers, your figures, and your tables are really reflecting the underlying database. And then here at the end, one other good practice is to know to put to give information on how was your computing environment. In this case, at least we are able to tell which version of R we have been using, and other libraries that have been used in this document. So you see here all the packages that were attached under the hood from within R in using this document. So it's also very easy. There's one function here in R that does this for you, the session inf, and it's just another fragment over here. Again, if we want to just turn this off, we can use here the settings document, output, show output only, apply, and we see here echo, save our document. This again would be something that we really want to show mainly the output, not so much the function, because possibly everybody seeing this document kind of knows this now. So now we have a very simple and straightforward solution to write combined documents in the literate programming style using R and Markdown, and basically make it quite a complete environment for scientific reporting. So there are several nice add-ons or goodies within RStudio, which we also can look at in a moment, but maybe this would be also an opportunity for everybody just to play around with some of these options. So maybe one I do here. Yesterday we had a lot of talk about this using this Magritte library, so maybe we can change this there, because now what you see here, for example, it's getting a little bit complicated, you know, with summary on top of cars and doing all this transformation. So in this case, we would be possibly making it clearer. What is happening here is, if you use the magnet library, then we start out the pipe, and then what we do is summary, you know, the pipe, and then we do the knit R and check if everything is okay here. Yes, we get the same result. But now, no, also we see here, yes, it's really a fully compatible R mini environment within this little code chunk, and it does all the things as we do in documents, and now in a normal R Studio source code. But also here we see again the advantage of using this MyGritta pipe character, because it makes it much more readable what is happening. You can really see how our data flow, you know, from cars to the summary function, and then we do the formatting for the table using this table function. So in the case now we wanted, okay, now it makes it very clear, so we can maybe just take out this option, and then when we have then we have a document that is clean, very is a table one. I should obviously change this. Yeah, so now we have a nice instructive code fragment, no, on how the code is here transformed into the subsequent table. And we can now get rid of the second table here, because that's just now duplication. And again, on the level of the editor, it's really just like another text fragment. We just now get rid of this fragment or chunk, and again, and see how we just are dealing with text in both cases. It's in the R chunk and outside in the Markdown environment. That is some room now for everybody to also practice, no, to insert another empty code fragment maybe, and try some code of R. So how was it to insert a code fragment? You remember? Well, you have two possibilities. You can copy, or we can use a very simple one. Or insert R, and we get an empty one. So maybe everybody has now some time to just practice here with R statements. For example, one other data set that is available readily in R is the iris data set, this flower measurement. Your R skills now to investigate what is in this R iris table, maybe make a plot of some of the variables. We have an example to how to do this with cars. You can make a summary. So first we could make a summary like this fragment here, and then the script is called, this was a question about the options. This echo is false, means I don't show code, source code within this fragment. I just turn it off. Sometimes I don't want to show the code of something which is sometimes, for example, in this case, I don't want to show the source code of the plot, but I can just also show it. So that's what happens. So here, you see here is the code, no, for the plot below. So sometimes I don't want to show this. So now you see in this document that text has gone. No, the source code has gone for before this graph. Yeah. So we sometimes want to put in the source code, maybe like here, and sometimes we don't want. So you see is the standard output of the table is here in this way, with the hash text before. It's not so nice, so it's why better to use maybe this knitr cable function to make it a nicer format. But yeah, anyhow, so the main function is here to remove or show the source code of this op. Again, if you want to know more about these different options, you can just settings or settings main options menu, where you can have a dialogue now to guide you, and it shows here, it says here explicitly what you can do. You want to show output only. No, that's what is meant with echo false. So if you want to show code and output, no, this echo is, and if I show nothing, just run the code, no, then it's a silent, would be a silent one, which might make sense sometimes. In this case, not, and and show nothing and don't run code, so it can basically just keep sometimes I wanted to maybe keep in some code and but I don't want to run it. Maybe it's very costly, so maybe I can make a reference to source code to assemble a de novo genome that takes a while, so I don't want to use it every time I make a calculation for the document, so I can, but I want to keep the code for maybe the documentation of the paper, and so I just keep it as this eval, but set eval to false and include also false, so it won't interfere with the rest of the code. So it doesn't do anything here. So you see, you can see what every, you just observe what happens also with this other one, so warning, or warning is false. So it means if code is executed, it shows either messages or not. Same is true for other options here, page tables, custom size figure. So you can, instead of typing, you can also just use this kind of nicer interface here, not to set your options in this. And basically it's just in a convenient way. You can also just copy or edit in the in this fragment line here, in the option line. Any other questions? So again, this is a little bit the point in time to get practice and possibly work in your document with the data set from Iris and just try to modify, insert a table and insert a plot and make a reference to some of the summary results, like the number of rows in the Iris data set. Now you basically can look on the prior fragments on how to implement this. Use the comments here and here. So first question, everybody has been able to do all the three main tasks. Yeah? The basic one was first make a summary table, then make a plot of two variables, and then insert value into the sentence, the inline R fragment. Everybody has been doing this? Okay, good, great. So, just as a reminder here, here's a, in the quick reference, you have also the syntax again, which you could also use to copy over here. And here you have also the syntax for the inline R code. Now just sometimes difficult to find this this specific character here, so if you want to do that, either can use here, or if, as you know, you can insert from here. Okay, a small addition, and we'll complete this exercise here with the references. Now where do I get this kind of formatted references if I don't want to type it myself? An easy way is if you know reference title, then you can go to Google Scholar, search for your kind of reference you want to use, maybe Newton's Big Work, and then here you can see that icon here with the two apostrophes, and that gives you pre-formatted citations in a variety of formats. In this case, what we need is the one, it's called BibTeX. And so here we get the BibTeX format. Just use that one to just add another entry here into this file, in the reference bib file. And then I can, again, just copy this one and make a new citation. If you recall here, somewhere below, we can now add another one, the knitting here. And so I see I have my two citations and I get a new entry and the reference. And so I can build up my references in the file. Okay, so now we have seen how to build basically a document for reproducible analysis from the ground up a little bit. And there are new some goodies within RStudio available that make life even more fun for making this kind of files. And one is here under R Markdown. You can see, for example, here a presentation, and you can make a PowerPoint presentation from this kind of format. So we just used this one. And now you understand already, and you see the simple thing we basically add in the meta file, in the metadata section here is a magic word called PowerPoint presentation. And that's all. And you see here some examples of some setup here. But basically, the main convention is within the PowerPoint file, the slides are separated, or each new slide starts with level two in Markdown. And you have to respect empty lines before and after the header at the second level. You can make slides with bullets, slides with output again, slides with plot. I can just auto-check here first. No? We know already. No? And you need to be on Windows or you need to have PowerPoint installed. So maybe on Mac, I don't know whether it really works on Linux, but you need at least to have underlying library available. And then we can just knit. And so I get my slides, no, a PowerPoint presentation. Very simple way of making lots of slides with all the calculations based on no real data. So again, we can use here our knowledge of R to maybe modify. Now we know, so as again, if you want to use this pipe character, it's the very beginning. It's a good idea to also put this in a kind of setup, all the libraries together. So here library, no, Magritta, which is the one library that puts us this piping character for us. And then I can use this, for example, I could use, no, the other way around. And plot, and now I can use maybe a line type is line, and yes, no, it does understand both the Magritta pipe command here, and it does also understand here. I shouldn't be having this comma maybe here, it doesn't matter. And again, I can even use different slide systems here. One is they're meant for HTML based slides. We'll just see how that looks. Yeah. Sometimes also here, this is actually a small browser based on library within RStudio. Sometimes better to use or more interesting to use the full blown browser on your system, so for full screen. And then you have an HTML-based presentation of the same thing, with different kinds of presentation systems. Okay, that's maybe something also to try out if you're getting the PowerPoint here running. And then another way is just also using here the standard Markdown document. Like sample two. This is, as we now see here, basically again just a simple, straightforward document. Now we know this is a desktop sample two. Yeah, so we see a different way here. It's just like we did before, but you get a little bit more to start out with. If you getting still used to it, it's maybe easier to just modify again the samples you find here, so we get already something and some text to help you recall what you. And then we have still another neat kind of Jupyter equivalent called our notebook. And again, this is so show our code, open browser. Yeah, so in this case it's empty, so this example here, so we can use this to, we can also view it within the environment of RStudio by using this option here to view in view or pane, and then it will be resulting in a visualization over here. So it makes it more is in the same window overall. A few more options. You can also do, create them over here from the main menu. And what else I wanted to show? Then again from Markdown, you have options for other kinds of templates. For example, for the GitHub. On GitHub, there are some specific options, so you can also use this menu here to create a GitHub optimized version of the Markdown document. So that's basically the main pre-configured templates within this RStudio. And then there are several other packages that provide additional possible templates. So to give you some more links where you can find out more. So one is here from RStudio. There is a Markdown reference guide, which allows you to basically also print it out neatly and have it basically on a couple of pages or four pages or five pages basically summarized both the Markdown and the R and how to basically use a lot of more options on the whole system here. You can use, for example, also animations and also do a lot more figure options on presenting the final output in the document. So this is one. You can also reach that from within the help, so from the cheat sheets. So this was the Markdown reference guide. There's another, maybe nicer presentation here, which is this one here, more colorful and a little bit more dense because it's only two pages. So that's a nice summary here. So let's go here. You get some recommendations here on how to organize yourself in terms of workflow. But basically that's what we have been following more or less. And some more advanced options on how to make interactive documents even. But that's also a little bit more advanced. Maybe we can see that also later on in the afternoon. Last thing, Markdown. So there are also other sites here for GitHub itself, for the Markdown, as I already said. And here on RStudio, Markdown, there is also more on document types and on, even here you can write whole articles in different styles with certain pre-configured formats, like for the Journal of Statistical Software or for Elsevier type articles. But for that you have to usually also install a specific package, and maybe not everybody wants to write a journal article right now, so I leave that for you to investigate. But basically it gives you a Markdown type template, and then it converts it into a format like in PDF that can be used for submission to a journal already. No? So I thought it's a little bit maybe out of range for this course for the moment, but just there's lots more options now and lots more templates available that you can use for your benefit in publications. Okay. Questions so far? Okay, what else we have here? We maybe get a few more minutes before breaking for lunch and can repeat a little bit what we were now aiming next at. So now what we have in terms of now working on reproducible bioinformatics analysis. Now we have a nice way to keep data and text and conclusions really organized. No? So what was the next problem usually is, you usually don't have the right analysis in the very first go. you have several iterations, no? And you make errors, so you go back and forth. And so to keep track of this on top of source code, be it just our source code or also be it just the combined document in terms of RMD format, so we need to have a system that helps us to keep track of all the changes. So that is now an opportunity to get to know this tool called GIT. It can be used just offline, and but it can also be connected to the online repository. So just maybe to show some general impression of the GitHub repository first. It's github.com, and basically it's has an interface and a spirit of kind of like a social network for programmers right now. So you see lots of different projects over here, and anyhow, to one of the tools I'm involved with, so I wanted to just use as an example. It's for my times before at ZIP, still continuing on. So here's a tool to access a database for breeding data from within R. And basically, you know, it allows you, what I just said here, to put in a README MD file. No, this is basically here on automatically, if you put this file in, it will just read it and display it in this way, almost like an HTML page. And here you can put in instructions on how it is to be used. For example, auto-installed, oh yeah, then I moved the tutorial. And here you can then go in, for example, to the R code and see the kind of changes that were made of late. So for example, here is one way to see here the latest commit was done on January 15th by a colleague or collaborator of mine. So this is what we use really, it's a collaboration platform. So you can see here also more insights. Now when from last week, so we were not very active there because we were busy with other things. Anyhow, so you see the contributors and how we have contributed over time here. So comments, so this kind of the social aspect of this project here. You can see we use it also for tracking our issues. No? So basically here we can be in contact with our users or put ourselves some tasks up here, no? Like in a normal help desk and an issue tracking system. And what is? Yeah, so this is mainly just to give you the first idea, no? Where we want to go. Then we have some options also to see more details on the source code a little bit later. So for the moment, the repository in general, no, and the repository is a copy of the source code, no, for your project, for your program. So the repository is just like a backup in general terms, no? But it's a backup that is linked to your local copy of all the source code. And the clone means you can download it and work with a copy of it, an entire copy. So clone means you get an identical copy, and then you can use it to import it within your own local system. So we can show you that a little bit later. So we would just copy this link and could use it also directly from within RStudio to start working with a copy of that source code. Okay, so as I said, this is kind of the independent but synchronized and linkable centralized backup system, but we start out with a local copy of it. So with a local EIT system. So within our we should within our tools of that stick USB stick, we should have a copy of the installer program. So it would be nice now to install this GIT on each laptop, and so then we can continue on in the afternoon. So there was okay. So maybe we go to the same to the very same main site for the Git SCM code. So here we can download this. I started this on my local system, but it should be on your computer if you have copied yesterday or on Monday all the programs. There was one that was this GIT system. So you just can now maybe use the time to install this GIT program. You don't need to download, I just wanted to show it, but you don't need to download it because I also will just stop it because I have already downloaded, it's installed on my one. So if you have it correctly installed, then you should get a screen like this on your PowerShell. No? So how do you get there? To just check here, so on search in Windows PowerShell, that's maybe the, we get this more fancy Windows command box or terminal, and then we just type Git and see if you get the same. So how are we doing? Everybody has been able to set up Git? Still missing? Todos estamos bien con Git o falta instalar en algunas computadoras? No? Yeah, okay. So maybe then just to 2 more minutes before we start working, we wanted to just show where we are going, so we are a bit free for this part. So on the Git main page, there is also quite a good documentation and also very good tutorial, so you can just use those. And they are basically, I would use here the book. And the book is available in many languages. I don't know about Turkish, but maybe, I don't know, but yes, Spanish and French and Greek. So you can choose your favorite language here. And basically we have been already gone up to 1.5. So we have been installing Git, and hopefully everybody was just able to check that it's running with typing the GIT command in the PowerShell or command window or on terminal on Mac. And so what we are going to do next is a first time Git set up locally on our computer, because everything is then later on registered with your credentials, basically, on your identity. And that same identity we will then be able to use on logging into GitHub if we use the same credentials also on GitHub. So you basically need to open up a terminal on your local computer. You can use that either from here, the command window, command prompt, or what's the version, PowerShell. PowerShell is more colorful. And basically now we can use Git config and see we need to put in a little bit more here on global, and for example username. If you just use it like that, then it will give you the username we have been using. So this is my you can use several usernames, but the one that you are using will be the one that we also been used for connecting later on to GitHub. So it's good to think about the username you probably would be using in public. And in case you start fresh, you probably will have some general names there, like John Doe or whatever. And for the email, we can do the same thing. So if you wanted to set the email, like the first username, we need to use the apostrophe. So let's say maybe Reinhard Simon, no? In my case. No? And then if I go here to user name, so now it's Reinhard Simon. And so very easy to set the credentials here. I just turn it back to what I had before. In my case, so you use your own username you want to use, not mine, por favor. So everybody, your name, not my name. Okay, same for the email address. Everybody use your own credentials. And the same credentials, it is recommendable to use the same credentials on GitHub later on. So use something and some email you want to use on GitHub too. So this is my, so please don't use this for your own. Yeah, just, okay, so you know you need to open a terminal on Mac or Ubuntu and command window or PowerShell on Windows. Yeah, and then you can just basically after the dollar and the space, you can copy over and replace John Doe and the John Doe example com email with your own name and your own email. As I said, as you know, also basically it's always better not to use a name with a space in it. So just use a simple name that you can use easily across operating systems. Okay, so everybody has been able to give yourself your identity locally and use the same identity for GitHub. Yeah. Todos estamos registrados con el usuario localmente y con el mismo usuario en GitHub. So we just follow here the tutorial online. We do not everything, just the main steps. So this one section on configuring an editor, that is not necessary right now. Maybe what you can do is not check our configuration. You can go here, git config list, and we should get lots of information back here. Yeah, so you should see that it works, and you should see that your user email and user name are registered correctly again. So it was done command. So I guess this one command we did already to check that our username is the one expected. So here getting help is similar to other commands on Unix. Right now I think we can skip a little bit, but we can try maybe help config. So you see the online options here for this command. Well, I should say this is just maybe for reference. For most of the time, we will just work with Git from within RStudio. But it's good to check sometimes to be able to do things also on the command line interface yourself. But for the moment, I would just go to a few examples with the Git interface in the command line. And then we go back to RStudio because RStudio has a nicer interface, so you can just point and click and we just have less to learn. Okay, so so lots of commands here to get to know. Yeah, so let's see, getting started summary. Yeah, okay, I think the main part that you need really to do on the command line is setting up of the initial credentials. And another important command is this command git clone. This is useful also if you have other projects that are not R project or able to be loaded into RStudio. So you would just use git clone and then you can use a repository online to download the whole over there via this command. So, but for the moment we leave it alone, and we just have now briefly before going to break, we will have two main options to start a Git repository. As already implicated, we can use the local machine to start a Git repository, and we can use the online GitHub repository also to start a repository. So then we have to decide which we want to do first, and then we can either upload a local repository to GitHub, or we can do it the other way around. So I think it's easier for us right now to start a repository locally. And so it's good, as few of us maybe have been working without Git before. So we just close all our RStudio, because if it had not been yet installed, RStudio needs to restart to find Git, and then be able for us, we will be able to use Git from within RStudio. So RStudio needs to be closed down first, and to make sure that it can find Git. For those who had already, we don't put a problem, but for the other people, it will be. So we just close, everybody, please. El RStudio, so RStudio. Mejor que todos, primero vamos a cerrar todas las instancias de RStudio y luego continuamos simplemente en abrir otra vez el RStudio. Y empezamos simplemente con un nuevo proyecto. We start then with a simple new project. And in this case, we use version control. So within version control, we have an option to use another system, subversion, but we use the first one now. And here we choose a simple name, a new name. So let's say INEA 3A, and we keep it also under our same master directory. And then we just hit, I'm sorry, now this was the way to start it from within, from a site on GitHub. So I need to show you first to how to then do it the other way around. Sorry, I was thinking to the other way around. So now we start better on GitHub. So first to register, start an empty new project over here. So I use sign in. as I said, there are two ways to start out with a Git project, locally or from the GitHub site. So we start out now from the GitHub site first, and so beside your icon here on the upper right hand corner, there is a plus sign, new repository, and there we give it the same name, INEA 3A, and we just have here some option to put in some text, but we leave it like that, and then we can leave it public, we leave it there, and maybe we just initialize it, this with a README file. Yes, so we have INEA 3A available under my major repository, and then I just hit create repository. Yes, and I get here an empty MD file, no README MD file, and now I could use here this button to download it, but I can also use now from within RStudio, where our dialog is here. But I need the full repository, sorry, the full URL. So where I do get this URL, I get it here. So clone this, and I have here a way to copy, hitting the button on the right hand side to copy that link, or I can also just mark it up. And now I copy this link over here. And then it will automatically also extract here the ENIA CA as a project directory name. And then it will start to clone that directory into my local instance, because it's basically empty, a few one line maybe in the README. So that's the only thing I have now in my README. And then I can just check, okay, here we have a single header line with the title of that project. Yes, that's we should see. So on the GitHub side, we just start out with hitting new repository, and then I give here a name in ENIA 3A. If I have it already, as I do now, I will get a reclamation because now I, on my account, I have already given this name. No puede hacerlo otra vez. Pero ustedes deberían tenerlo libre. Y simplemente nos marcamos acá, que se inicia con un archivo README y create repository. Yeah? And then I have this project right now here. And then I get need a link to refer to this repository, and I can copy that link over here. So to set up the connection with my local repository or future local repository. And then within the dialog, again, so how did I do this? New project, version control, git. And here I copy over the link, and as you see, automatically it will fill in the project directory name. And then I can hit again, create project, because I did that already now. It will be duplicating, so I won't do it again. But just for you to follow. Puede hacer es hago una segunda versión, otro repositorio, no me cuesta, pues, hago otro. En castellano. Acá voy a abrir un nuevo repositorio y le doy ahorita ENIA 3B, ¿no? Que es disponible. Y acá voy a iniciar el repositorio con algo, con un archivo README, y creo este repositorio y tengo el segundo. Luego voy a usar acá este menú a la derecha. Clone or download para copiar este vínculo lo voy a usar acá en new project control versiones, copio el vínculo acá y ya tengo el segundo repositorio y acá también puedo abrir una nueva sesión aparte de mi 3A. Entonces ahorita va bajando en la información. Y ahora es hora del almuerzo. Entonces, we will break now for lunch. And I think everybody has time still to set up last things or reflect on how this process was, and we can continue after lunch. And then after lunch, we will combine editing markdown documents and reproducer documents within a controlled system of tracking all the different versions and progress we make.